first phrase I remember hearing it that described the children's hospital to me was, I forget who used it, but the word organized chaos.
Which is a phrase that encompasses, to me, the institution itself, the staff, and of course the kids. It is an amazing physical and emotional accomplishment how this missionary carries on with its caring spirit after the volunteers have come and gone. But then again, it only takes one meaningful visit to this to truly understand how this works. And the answer to how it works is found in the kids. These children have been battling disease, malnourishment, pain, and death for as long as they can even remember. Yet somehow they still find some way to hold hope in their hearts. These children have watched with eyes full of tears as their mothers and fathers walked away from them, forced to abandon them because they didn't have the ability to properly care for them and provide them with what they need. These children have endured the trials and tribulations that would cripple the majority of the people in this natural world. Still, these children have a power that keeps happiness close in sight when only given a chance. When these children are given that chance to forget their hardships and live life the way it should be lived, they're simply just happy.
I see the healing in the children through no other way, or the most like primary way is like laughter. Like laughter is like the best medicine, and like we all go in there with the goal of like making like every child smile. Fevers have to be like 102, 103, 104, and like they just lay in bed, you know, just like sad.
But because we don't really have any medical expertise, I feel that most of our healing comes in the form of just caring for them and showing that other people care and through love.
They're HIV positive, and that these children just came into the world without like a chance, you know, to grow up and, you know, have a girlfriend or have a boyfriend and, you know, like just do regular things that, you know, kids will do, because most likely they'll pass away before they even hit their preteens.
I just kept putting like little cold compresses on him, and like he doesn't really smile, but you could tell that it felt better, like his skin was kind of getting cool. And I even asked the nurse, the sister, I was like, do you have like fever medicine I can give him? And she gave him whatever kind of fever medicine they have. And when we went back in the afternoon, he wasn't hot anymore. Like his little fever was gone.
And when I found out that Jean was positive, I took him outside. And like I guess he was like kind of not feeling good that day, because he's just, you know, sometimes he gets in his moods where he's just like, you know, and he'll just cry or whatever. That day he was just really just kind of real quiet. And I just laid him down and just started massaging him and praying for him and just telling him that, you know, your world is going to be beautiful no matter what, you know. And God is with you all the time. And it felt like he could understand me. Maybe just because I was just like, you know, massaging him the way I was and just, you know, rubbing his eyes and his head. And
but yesterday, he slept for the first time after I put him down. And that was just even more exciting, because not only did he trust me to fall asleep on, but like he trusted me to put him down. He knew that I was gonna come back. And in some ways, like, that was amazing because he does trust me, but in some ways it made it 100 times worse because Ashmar won't be coming back. So I'm really having a hard time dealing with that.
I don't know, just, you know, I think it's good. It's really, really very good that we're here and that everyone comes down, or, you know, people come down regularly, and that they spend time with the kids.
Close your eyes. Imagine your personal existence is infected with disease. You must go to the home for the dying because your family and friends cannot properly care for you. Now you're in a cement room. A breeze drifts gently across the rows of cots which surround you, full of men and women who share this ill reality. Emaciated and weak, you help feed your neighbor the daily ration of vitamin-filled stew. He refuses to eat and rests his weary head on the pillow. More likely than not, he will die tonight. Watching the flies glide through the musty room, you can't help but think of your own demise.
It's not that they're dying, it's just that they're living. And they're living, like, you know, every day, so just the fact, yeah, that they looked so relieved just to go and massage their back and, like, just to let them, like, live their last days with, like, dignity, basically. It's just an amazing healing process.
Over the last 2 weeks, I think the hospice really brought, the Home for the Dying really brought this out for me. It was the fact that healing is a journey by which we gather in other people. And I know I've shared this quote before, but it's one of my most favorites, and it definitely keeps me going. And that is that we are all angels with but one wing, and it is only by embracing another that we can fly.